I am a year and a half out from graduating my Bachelor of Science and a Diploma of Languages. So where I started quite a few years ago is I very much wanted actually to study architecture in high school and when I was growing up. But then I got to year 12 and I realized I had to do a folio, and I was not thrilled with the idea that a lot of work would go into something where it was very hard to in fact get a good mark, because it would come down to something that was subjective. And I'd always liked maths. So when it got to deciding the subjects that I would take in my last years of high school, I decided that maths and physics would be the way to go for me. So I got to university. I started, as I think we all do, calc, linear algebra. What else do you do? Real analysis, those subjects. I didn't particularly have a set goal at all when I started. My attitude has always been, I enjoy it, so I will do it. I definitely started the degree and wasn't particularly, I don't think, a strong student by any means at all. But I found that I was able to get through. I learned especially I think it's the problem solving mindset and the reasoning, and also this attitude that I have a problem on this page and I don't know the solution, so how do I figure it out? So I developed resourcefulness, and that was actually something that has kept me in very good stead since. In terms of selecting the major, so some people come into university and they know exactly what they want to do. I did not. I kind of played it by ear. Probably when I was halfway through the degree, I thought that I'd do applied maths. Then a bit later on, I thought, oh, maybe I'll do operations research. And then I ended up doing more of the pure maths subjects. In terms of perception, I think that I started in a place with very little direction. I ended in a place with a degree and direction, maybe not so much. It's very difficult, I think, when you're at university to understand like what comes next. And I met a lady who came from the current consulting firm where I am, and she was very engaging. She seemed very clever. She'd done some computer science studies, and now she was working in a team that was specializing in data and data analytics. And after the panel session, I actually spoke to her and she was absolutely lovely. And I said to her, actually, I was like, oh, you're a really cool person. What do I need to do to work with people like you? And she said, oh, well, conveniently, we have a grad program and you should apply. So I did. And then that's where I wound up. Now, to be honest, when I started working, I found it very difficult. There is a huge, and I mean like huge, gap between university and the world of work, because university, you are the agent of your own time. You make the decisions. Am I studying right now? Am I studying in an hour's time? How am I going to go about studying? Who am I going to study with? In maths as well, we don't do a lot of group projects. So you often don't even have the constraint of having to work with other people. And you've got this life that is, it's got a very fluid structure. When you get to work, all of a sudden, this is 9 to 5. And it doesn't matter what mood you're in. It doesn't matter. You are there and you have to work. And the very big difference is that at university, you learn, you absorb things. In work, you have to produce, output things. So this is a very different way of operating. Previously, the only thing you had to output was proof of understanding. Now you have to have as a basis proof of understanding to be able to do something. So fix someone's business problem or provide an investment case for something. So it's very different. And I think that it is a lot more tiring. You know, I'm about a year and a bit in and it's getting better. What is, however, interesting is that you also sometimes have to, I think, be very resourceful. I come back to that because especially in consulting, typically they call you when things have gone terribly, because they're not going to spend all that money if things are going well. And so usually it's because, I don't know, all their systems aren't working, or they have huge data quality issues, or they don't have a way of accessing their data, or maybe they've had all these data breaches and they need to do something about it. And they bring you in and you're kind of in this situation where it's like, what is going on? you try and define things up front and be like, this is your problem, this is a solution, here is your team that will come and fix it. But at the same time, there's a high level of uncertainty and you are paid as the expert. So you have to come in and be like, okay, and then very quickly get your head around the company, their systems, their problems, who you need to talk to, who make the decisions, who you need to speak to in the technical teams, for example, to fix the problem. And often problems are like dynamic problems. Like they think this is the problem and then they start working on it and they discover that there's like a whole other set of things that need to be fixed and dealt with. And so, yeah, you have to be quite creative and very proactive. And that's what I enjoy. I enjoy talking to people, being proactive and being creative. So I came out with a pure math specialization and no one in industry hires for a pure maths degree. It's a lie. What they hire for is the scientific type approach or the quantitative skills or the proof that you can hack through a degree that's a bit harder than the average degree. They don't hire for the pure maths degree. They don't care. Half the time, they don't even know what that means. So you just say, yes, okay, I studied maths, and then they're happy and you move on. Did I apply anything that we did, for example, in my geometry class? Like, no, I have not applied those things. So it's kind of, I would say the skills I learned at university were applicable, even though the content wasn't necessarily so. I actually did have to learn a lot on the job. Everyone in my team could code. So that was something that I had to learn. I thought I would receive a bit more training on the job, which I didn't receive on the job. It was more trial by fire. I got put on a project where I basically just had to learn. And I was very lucky in that someone, my manager, went out of her way to teach me how to code. And for example, now I'm moving on into a different part of the business and working on a different project. And now I'm having to get better at like Python, for example. If I could give one piece of advice, is probably learn how to code when you're at uni, especially if you're going towards what is now a very like popular field, which is the field of data and data science. And kind of. So I have studied in China and I have also lived in France for a brief period of time. I think that in China, they have a slightly less bizarre attitude to Australia in terms of women in maths, because I think Australians are very behind with their thinking. It's very archaic. It's just like, oh, women can't be intelligent, or a woman doing a science or an electrical engineering degree is just unfathomable. You still see these attitudes everywhere, really. Only 16% of people in the STEM workforce are women, which is just ridiculous. Like, that is tiny. It's just a drop. So I think Chinese people, or the ones that I spoke to, I met more girls who were interested in maths, but I still think that like very sexist views still exist. That's the same. with a different flavor, I guess. And then in France, I think that from what I understand, like, yes, there is like a history of probably more pronounced than in Australia of women studying maths. But still, it's not necessarily the norm. For example, my mum, so obviously that's a generation prior. So she did her engineering, so civil engineering studies in France, and she was one of very, very few girls in her school. And there was a lot of, I mean, she's told me that she had to deal with a lot of like comments and et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, that like you just don't want to have to deal with. And that for one of her internships, she in fact wrote her cover letter. So French has this thing where you can write where words are masculine or feminine. And when you write about yourself, you will change the words depending if you're a man or a woman. And she actually wrote one of her cover letters in such a way as to remove every single type of gender pronoun so that she could get an internship, and it worked. And when she received the approval, it was addressed to Mr. So-and-so. So like, okay, that's only, you know, a generation ago. So it's, I think there's still some changes to be made. I think that what is, however, very good is that, like, the fact that we're talking about it is a great thing. And I think that there are some really, really good initiatives. And one initiative that I think just deserves every award, every praise, is the AMC Choose Maths initiative. And that's been running for quite a few years now. And it's an incredible program that brings together teachers and students and universities to encourage women to go into maths. And what I like about them is they're really about practicing what they preach. They took out these incredible ads on trams all over Melbourne where they put up photos of women who had studied and worked in maths, and they made it very public. They fund programs for teachers to strengthen their maths skills. They have competitions, they have awards. They're really doing an incredible job of getting young Australian women into maths. And so, yeah, so there's some really good stuff happening as well. And I think that that should, of course, be celebrated. Absolutely. I think that it will get better. The fact that we're talking about it, the fact that universities are making decisions about hiring, they're making decisions about promotions, and some countries are looking at quotas. I think that these are steps forward. So I think that it will get better. The question though is the rate of change. So currently I think the rate of change is too slow. I think the change that is happening is good. I think it can be faster. And I think that that requires conscious decisions. So universities making decisions, firms making decisions about hiring. In terms of our media as well, we need to make sure that we've got representation. So for example, if we're calling experts on a panel, we need to do our best to get 50-50 representation. Really, really realizing that it's like a multi-pronged approach. People at university are talking about it, but I also think it needs to be a conversation that happens in the broader Australian public. And that, I think, comes down to a lot of limiting views that we have about gender in Australia. The change is good. We can accelerate it, though.